Hit out towards second. Fielded by Adore. And he's set down, one away.
Now batting.
It is Curtis Granderson. He's gone deep twice in the game, making him 2 for 4. He's ready. Here's the first offering. As anticipated, here's a ground ball now to the right side. On to first, and a good stretch over there is going to get him by a step for the second out.
The batter, number two, second baseman.
Oh, anybody gonna come out?
Hanley Ramirez. Man. On the night, he's 2 for 4 with a pair of
six. He was out to me. Let's take a look. He got him by the foot.
First pitch of the at-bat. In the air out toward right field. Chu has a read on it. He makes the play, and that'll end the inning. Pretty painless half of the inning, all told.
Okay.
Ninth inning coming up. Chicago leads this one 15 to nothing. In now the power-hitting outfielder, Nomar Mazara. Starting things for his side in the ninth as they face the improbable odds of trying to come back in this one.
Yeah, not a lot of hope for them at this point. These guys know these bats still count, at least for their own stats. You can't mill your chances as a professional.
Good hard slider there, but it runs away. It's a ball and a strike. 1-1 pitch is a slider that's cut on and missed for strike two. Now the 1-2 pitch. 1-2 is an off-speed pitch. No dice. It's 2-2. And he should be okay to go the distance here. He's just now about to hit 100 pitches for the ball game.
The one and out. I mean, 100 pitches are into the ninth inning. I know he's not gotten out yet, but it really looks good. What a strong outing for him.
Robinson Chirinos will grab a bat and hit for the pitcher here. First pitch hacking here, and that's the first strike. Bases are empty. One man out. And a fastball just below the knees, ball one.
Well, he's throwing a lot of pitches in this one, but it's not like he's walking a bunch of guys. Only one free pass.
Ah, there
point,
we go.
They're still making him work really hard.
You know, always that
so
kind of hit.
No
the bullshit
to the
ass hit.
Here in this one as
yeah, it
after
be because the motherfucker
no
on
hit bullshit. They finally get to him for their first hit of the ball game.
Rats. Always do it. Always do it, man. I have had so many games. I didn't pitch a couple more hitters. Don't get me wrong. But I have had so many games with the hits are just like that. Little fucking bleeders through the motherfucking infield in the ninth inning.
Hit ball to second. Look at Ramirez. What a play.
Motherfucker, take that.
Stepping in, Delino DeShields. He's their last shot here with two away in the ninth as they look to avoid the shutout.
Yeah, it's like the computer was going to get that here. You can tell that was computer conduced.
I think he wanted that pitch.
There wasn't no regular gameplay. You can tell that the computer took over that animation and made sure that these motherfuckers got that hit. And we'll hit it for you.
Now a swing and he pops him up.
We'll get him, Hanley.
And he will make the catch, ranging backward as he just put the glove up and hauls it in for the final out of the ball game.
Wow, you could feel the electricity in the air when the ninth inning started. Everyone could feel how close to history we were, but he gives up a hit and loses the no-hit bid. Man, that hurts. He's just got to shake it off now and enjoy this one hitter just the same. Great effort either way.
15-0 the final in this one. Nick Martinez was only able to work four innings as he takes the loss. So that's a wrap here tonight. For my partners in the booth, Harold Reynolds and Dan Plesac, and our entire crew, I'm Matt Vaskirjan. You've been watching MLB The Show. And for more, click on over to theshownation.com.
Time of the ballgame, 4 hours exactly. Thank you for
trying to glue them shoes together. Do you remember everybody bought them shoes from him and they were so happy? And do you remember that them shoes fell apart on the kids? The shoes were breaking apart when they were walking down the hallway.
But guess what? You don't buy the Lonzo Ball. other day. I don't know if it was, I think it was a Jordan, right? But it was like all kind of spaced out and shooting on the floor. And they were getting sold for like $70,000. This guy happened to have one son. And he was like, I don't know if I'm going to sell them or keep them. I don't know. But other things you've never seen in your life. So $7,000 pair of shoes, right? $7,000 shoes, right? That you don't wear every day. Don't wear in basketball. What is it for? It's for status. You wear a Jordan, because I'll tell you one thing right now. If you can get a Jordan, and you can get another shoe, exactly like a Jordan, but it don't say Jordan, and people aren't going to buy that same shoe. People won't buy the Jordan. They ain't got nothing to do with quality. But I'll tell you right now, Jordan is the most unfindable shoe you can ever wear.
LeVar Ball's brand is I am man. It's right here.
Why did you not, but it seems like
I'm not giving him the I am indifferent. I'm not giving him my $500. I would have spent $1,200 on this kid. Now, if I had a son, would I spend that kind of money on those shoes for him? The answer would be no. However, if he had a job and he wanted to buy them himself, then I wouldn't stop him. You know, but it's just like, I feel like some kind of way he can't get his job done without it being controversial, and I don't understand why the controversy has to some kind of way be based around color, and I feel like everybody who participated in that shit is wrong. Well, this is my thing, y'all, who is wrong. I feel like all of y'all have to be wrong.
But this is the first time that it has been something to do with race.
No, it has not. The underlying issue since day one has been people saying the reason why he is having a hard time is because he's black.
Who said that?
There are several people all over YouTube that are showing articles, and I mean, that has been the conversation since he came out here.
I don't see how that is when he's been going from such a so it ain't never been about race to me, because I mean, tell you the truth, he's a light skinned dude. Maybe he's a dark skinned dude, he's different, but he's a light skinned individual dude. You know, and they're not coming at him thinking like that. Now, but most importantly, it would have been about race to say he was making black people look bad, look bad by the way his actions are. You know, that would have been nobody saying that. Nobody saying he's making black people look bad. You know, people are saying that he is doing what he is supposed to do. Now, you said controversy, I get that still. Because people love negativity.
Well, I feel like you make black people get bad when you get on TV and say you're afraid of kids.
Yeah, that's the only point you say that stuff on.
I feel like, I mean, what you say on TV, because you thought about it, when I was a documentary or not, like, what comes out your mouth, you know, that's coming from somewhere. And it's just something about, I mean, but with that being said, that's not tangible, you know? And he could have been just playing or whatever the case is.
I mean, but I wouldn't care if, you know, stuck his weenie in the oven and the oven had the baby. And he said, I had a baby, made sex with the oven to create this kid.
If LeVar Ball was here, and I am doing this for a cause, for an actual collective community, not just my own, you know, because I want to be rich, then that would give me some type of incentive. I'm not saying that you have to have an incentive. I'm not saying shut him down, nobody should talk to him. You know, I'm not saying that.
But I guess what I'm trying to do is understand why, because when he says that I am, He never say, I ain't trying to get all the money. He's trying to get his family working.
The same reason why I don't support Beyonce, Jay-Z, and none of the rest of them. You know what? Good for you. You know what I'm saying? I bet you do need a mansion. You understand what I'm saying? But I'm not going to take money that goes to my life, gas, my money goes to my actual necessities. My money doesn't go to that kind of frivolous stuff. When I make a shoe purchase, when I make a pocketbook purchase, when I purchase my hair, I have to be conservative, you know, because I need my money to take care of my overhead. You guys, so therefore, why do I need to make sacrifices in my household so that you can have more of, y'all got too much. Y'all burning money in the music video. This is how, you know what I'm saying? So it's not something that I feel just about LeVar Ball. I just, something about these people, period, who are basically leveraging the idea that so many of us want to see young, successful entrepreneurs and new entrepreneurs and new businesses, especially if it's going to be a black father, and how positive that imagery can be. We are really rooting for that, and we really want to see it, but it's not being reciprocated when the person tells me, I'm just doing this for me and mine. Okay, well, you know what? I'm going to wait until the next person comes along who gives it to the ball. I saw your house in the documentary. You got a basketball court. So I don't feel like you need another $500. Not for me. No, if that status that other people may feel from wearing those shoes, that status to me ain't even tangible. Because nobody gonna see me wearing your shoes and hire me because of it. They might just want to be my friend and think I got money and want to come over to my house and eat up my food. But it's not the kind of status that's going to do anything for me. They're going to think I'm a baller so they can come borrow some money, though.
But I understand.
People who really are ballers don't know I'm broke and I got all some expensive shoes.
But when you put it in that light, I think everybody could relate. But that's not it, though. Okay.
Well, that's just where I'm personally coming from. No, I don't feel like that's
but
fair.
But you can't even say that, you know, you feel like all the way like that. Because will you spend $700 on a bundle of hair?
Okay, well, put it like, no, let's go back to LeVar Ball. I went on the website. He has hoodies that are $60. I would spend $60 on one of those hoodies.
Okay.
I would. I like those shirts that he had that say, stay in your lane. Mm-hmm. They a little bit too. Spend like $50, but I get it. But you know what? Okay, $50. I would. I'm okay with it, you know what I'm saying? But would I spend $500 on your diamond too? And I kind of feel like you're trying to be, but I feel like it's a sucker born any minute, and so whoever want to buy your status, that's not going to give them anything tangible in return. You know, it's not an investment. So, I mean, knock yourself out. And we have a problem in our community anyway with spending money on tennis shoes the hell as it is. That's why the Jordans is such a problematic issue, because people trampling each other already over them damn shoes, and you can get some good Jordans and have the price of these shoes. And Jordan doesn't come out and say, hey, you guys stop fighting over my shoes, or I'm giving back and I'm doing this and that. You can't even approve it. He finally gave somebody some money like last year or something like that. It was like breaking news. Michael Jordan stingy ass and broke some bread with somebody, you know? So it's like, we already have problems with this, you know? And it's just, I know the NBA ain't going nowhere and all of that, but it's just something about the culture of the NBA and these damn tennis shoes and these kids, you know, banking their whole life on sports that I feel like it keeps us just somewhere stuck. And I think that he represents, I feel like that's what he represents for me. Now, I'm not overanalyzing. This probably won't be for everybody, but I feel like he represents that. All I need is a micro and basketball. You know what I'm saying? God, we spend our money on expensive tennis shoes. And that formula is working for him, but it's not going to work for him. It's like, if I wouldn't try that at home, it's not going to work for anybody else.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's not going to work for anybody else. What doesn't work for everybody is, just put everything on the line for basketball, and it's going to come through, and this big dream, and this money, and all that kind of stuff, and I'm going to be wealthy, and, you know. And that's what a lot of people are banking on. And it's to the point where it's like, oh, God, it's going to be whatever, I'm going to get over it. So, you know what I mean? I don't even know if it's important to talk about it.
But I just wanted to make sure that it wasn't about, you know, your preference. I mean, like I said, like when you speak about the shoes and a price and a life that you spoke about, talk about, I'm not going to put that over any of my other priorities. I'm not going to suffer because I'm not going to go broke by getting shoes.
Right, like I'm not going to buy a $500 Louis Vuitton either.
Right. Okay. I think everybody could relate to that.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But I don't think that's what he is trying to go for. You know what I mean? I don't think that he is trying to go for that. There's NFL players that came out and said, hey, I bought a pair of shoes. You know? A couple NBA players said, hey, I bought a couple of shoes. You know? Stuff like that. People that really support him in what he's doing. Not because they see shoes is so high. Yeah, that's okay. I mean, some people got some money just to go buy the shoes.
Exactly.
You know, and maybe that's who he's making it for.
Exactly. So that's my thing is. So then that should be who defending him.
But who is Michael Jordan making the shoes for?
Michael Jordan need his ass what?
So who's Louis Vuitton making their stuff for?
Louis Vuitton need their ass what?
So I mean, so what gives Louis Vuitton its status?
Yeah, but see, the other thing is Louis Vuitton is a foreign brand. So I can't tell you that if I was actually, you know, at the headquarters or where these things are coming, you know, maybe if we went shopping in Paris, then a lot of stuff, I'm sure, probably wouldn't cost as much as it does to be a purchase it over here. You know, so that is the fact that these are high fashion brands and they've been in high fashion magazines and a lot of these brands have been around for decades. Or, hell, some of these brands have been around for 50, 60, 70 years, you know what I'm saying?
But I respect the fact that...
And they have longevity and they stuff don't fall apart.
Yeah, okay. I understand that.
I never seen anybody with our ball. This girl can very well walk away.
But it is expensive for Louis Vuitton. Okay? But I'm saying this. So I respect the fact that he, the boy ball, is able to make his own shoe and make his own status. Nobody is giving him that status. He's making his own status.
Yeah, but see, but that's kind of the way. Okay, now watch this. Let me see this. You right. You right. And so this part of the conversation is not about even attacking him or his decision. Anybody that supports him, I'm trying to have a more broader conversation about society in general, okay?
Okay.
And we're just using the ball, LeVar Ball, to illustrate.
Right?
And the black community is part of America, the American community. This is a problem we're having, right? With lack of resources and education in the communities that produce basketball players the majority of the time. Now, in this particular case right here, not so much, okay? And there's also something to be said for that. For the difference that it made that these young men had their fathers in their life, their father in their life, and that he was able to provide certain things for them and had the wherewithal to at least look. I mean, some of what he's doing might be just so unprecedented because a lot of these basketball players only have their ratchet ass mama. A lot of these women learn on the fly. They you know, after the money come in, they get a little bit more refined and they bump their head a little bit. They learn about contracts and some of them. But a lot of people are in the NBA coming into it without having parents who are very knowledgeable. And now, of course, Kobe and Steph Curry, there are several exceptions to the rule, you know. But it's quite possible that maybe some of this is just unprecedented because there aren't as many really knowledgeable parents or family units coming into this NBA situation to be able to kind of test it and see what all it can do, you know?
Right.
I just, that part is good for the culture and good for the NBA as well, especially since it's not going nowhere, you know? It's just, and we can't control how people act, but it's just something is kind of cool. I'm sorry.
You know what I mean? So, give me a second, because I mean,
would you like
only me?
Like, if I was at a bar and, like, I heard him talking to his friends, I would be like, who is that loud ass clown that y'all got with you? Calm down.
Ain't hey, cool.
You know, I don't feel like his brand isn't cool. Like, that ain't cool. It's not sophistication. It's not cool. You don't behave or articulate yourself in a way that's giving me business. brand, because the real, and I read methodology, you know, what's really going to determine the longevity of your brand and how well you do is your ability to manage it. You know, it really not your even your sales for this year to do great. You know, but what about the life cycle of this business? How's that gonna work? But they just have to be determined. But we can't change how this man is going to be, because they haven't been tested yet. They're probably being tested now, but we won't know. We're gonna give him a year to give him 6 months, you know. I think he's an idiot savant. I think he's a broken clock, okay. I think a broken clock is right twice a day. And I think that this guy is very good at knowing, looking like he knows what he's talking about. But I do think that he's a bit of a jive turkey. And this is just the impression that I'm getting from him. But like, he's a jive turkey.
Well, I feel like this.
But some of that might be necessary for the one he's talking to, you know?
Well, at the same time, but I feel like this. If your theory is true, you know, and he meant it when he said, if he meant what he said by, you know, I'm gonna find me a tall woman or a tall white woman and have kids with her. He's been, this guy has been putting this master plan together for 19 years.
But that's not business savvy.
In the brain,
that don't mean
has been trying to take over the world every single day. And I hate to bring the cartoon into the mix. They ain't took it over yet.
Okay, but there's no guarantee that if I put my credit card into that website, that them shoes is gonna show up at my door.
Well, have you put your credit card in?
No, I thought that nobody gets their shoes.
Well,
they say you gotta pre-order them on the website.
They probably not made there.
So, oh, you want me to get you $500 and you ain't made them yet?
Who knows? What's going on?
Who knows? That's my freaking point.
But my
why you sitting out here?
But my thing is this, though. If you don't believe in it, you don't do it. That's everybody's option. At least he is telling you that you have to pre-order them. Because maybe he's waiting the Lakers opening day. I'm sure the guy has more than one shoe.
You got your shoes. He probably did. Probably got four pairs.
You know, you have to pre-order other stuff and you trust it. Matter of fact, you pre-order fast food. If you go to a fast food place, you pre-order it.
You sit right outside the manufacturing place.
Now, who said they have to open that glass and give you food? Or who said it's going to be the quality to what you expected to get?
It might not be the quality.
You trust it because it's been there.
I don't give them $500.
You know, but you gave them $10 and that's
no,
enough.
No, what you said was I trust it because it's been there.
Yeah, you trust it.
Nobody's done business with this
thing. Okay, but so give him time.
Okay.
Like what I'm saying.
Okay.
You know.
That's it.
If we go to McDonald's, if I go to McDonald's, okay, I say, let me get a number one. And they say, it's going to be whatever price, pull up to the window. Wait. They got two windows. The first one will take your money. And then you roll to the second window and hope to give you the food. But we trust that process.
Yes.
But when it comes to somebody, particularly a black man, when a black man is on the internet...
I just don't want to hear black men and LeBron Ball in the same sentence.
Why?
Because you said he reached...
You know what? Never mind. If you guys feel that you want to invest into this big baller brand, you feel like these Lonzo Ball shoes are going to give you status or will make you feel better about your self-esteem, you can do whatever you want to do with your money. So, go ahead. If them shoes fall apart, like the shoes did on Wayne's head, and the glue and everything, and the sole come apart and all of that, you know, don't come, don't cry on us. But if it work out, you know, then I guess we have to eat crow on that one. You know what I mean? I do hate that he can't just go on this journey as an entrepreneur and a father. I don't like the race conversation in connection with LeVar Ball because he has made it clear that he ain't worried about that. So I just don't feel like we should either. That's all my whole thing is with that. Do you have any other points you wanted to make?
One point I'd like to make is about something you said.
Buy Lonzo Ball shoe, and so happens to fall apart or whatever. This is what you do. You know, you put it in a glass box, and, you know, say, these are like, He should offer a damn warranty. How does he warranty in this description?
It comes a collectible. Right? But I don't think Lonzo Ball's shoes are going to fall apart. And furthermore, I happen to believe that, you know, this guy is doing an amazing job as a father. And I think that that should be recognized more so than it should. That's what I'm saying. I'm closing.
Alright, well, that's very fair, and I really appreciate your assessment. Like I said, you definitely add a great perspective to the conversation and fair shake, especially in terms of what he's trying to do. And that's why I wanted to discuss this with you, because I know you have an unbiased opinion, and also the consumer vantage point, as you are a part of that target demographic. Alright, so thank you very much for being my guest today, Donnie. I'm talking to you. All right, y'all. So in the case of Sister Monique, Lee Daniels, Oprah Winfrey, and Tyler Perry. Okay. I know I always got the unconventional opinion on this, but I feel like it's awfully hypocritical for somebody who participates in detrimental imagery and who continually plays stereotype in order to get on, to be noticed, knowing it's a stereotype, and then continually complaining about the very same system that they're capitalizing off of. I find that often incredible. It's like, I understand the game is cheating you, but if you lay down the dogs, you wake up with fleas. Anyway, and you know this. Now, in your body of work, since the beginning of your career, you have been playing this stereotypical, loud, big, black woman. And yes, that woman does exist. And if you are her, or you identify with her, and you feel that that role is so important for you to continue to play it over and over and over again, then that's your prerogative. But when you come out and complain, though, and say that you're being taken advantage of and treated unfairly, and this is because this is how black women are treated, well, what did you do to raise awareness about the way that black women are treated? Because you didn't do that in your body of work. You don't have a single body of work that addresses the way that black women are treated in Hollywood. And you know what? That's a movie story that I would like to go see, honey. Oh, no, wait, I'm lying. She did bring me Bessie, who played on TV, which is a bomb-ass HBO movie. However, you know what's going on with that show? We just insist on it. We just insist. I mean, basically, the underlying part of the story was like, yeah, they were black women who were really successful in music. But what you do for them was, they were black. But when you put your own money behind producing a film of your own, just you and your husband, anybody else in that? Or, you know, maybe you put a trip together without the major studios and all that kind of stuff. You said, this was your project, from my understanding. Okay? Imagery of white two black women acting
3 for 4 this evening. Hammered deep left center field. Way back. Goodbye. Wow. Adrian Beltre and their Angels walk it off. 7-6. We'll be right back.
pitching and one that are going to go far. You keep pitching the three same guys. And then the bullpen, I mean, you know, the bullpen is the one you have.
I got some stuff that I'm doing on the Walmart, on the counter. Do you see that? Well, that's what I'm doing.
Okay, well, I'll just tell you, okay? Because you got to grab the chicken leaves so it's going to spoil
it. You want to deal with the fry, that's what you do. You ain't gotta, I ain't got to be your spokesman for that.
Right there, thumbnail, the one that people ask me about that is, do my Steeler thumbnail always go the one of the last time I did it?
Champions of the American League. Donaldson, Stefanis, Pierce, yeah. They do, but they haven't kept them. I mean, they had Addison Russell in their prime system. And they traded them for Jason Campbell and Jackson Marsha for whatever reason, I don't know why. Golden silver in the first pack, I told you. When you open packs during my stream, go and say something. That was coming fast, though.
gonna eat it. Okay, I'm back.
Peace.